Would you please stand? I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and is committed to me in faith shall not die forever. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Good morning and welcome to St. Mary's Anglican Church. I'm the Reverend Karen Hatch. I'm the interim priest in charge. And it is indeed a delight to be here with all of you to celebrate Ed's life. It's so wonderful to see so many of you, including your worship, the mayor, Dave West. And I believe I saw Karen Civilitz here as well. So thank you all for coming. I'm going to open with Psalm 23. Would you please have a seat? I think Psalm 23 gets a really bad rap. It's often known as the funeral psalm. But I think what it really is a psalm reminding us of God's presence. God's presence in good times, bad times, joy-filled times and sorrow-filled times. So if you're willing, I would ask you to close your eyes and see Psalm 23 as a time that God is in our presence at all times. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. It's also times like these that we don't just remember that we're in the presence of God. We come together to remember our loved one, to remember Ed. So we call this time a time of remembrance. And I will call on Vito, then Ashley, and then Rick to share some memories with us.
Good morning. It's with a sad heart that I said goodbye to my dear friend Ed, who I knew for 30 years. On December 20th, I called Ed to let him know that I spoke with Mayor West, and he arranged to place a photo of Ed with the late Mayor David Barrell in the new addition of the Ed Sackfield Arena. That's when Ed said goodbye to me and told me he had arranged his passing for the next day. Even though I was aware this might be coming, I was shaken. I became emotional to the point I had trouble speaking. Ed sensed my grief. He called me the next day, just hours before his passing, to check in on me. Imagine that. He was so brave, so considerate, and so caring that he wanted to make sure I was okay. That speaks to his character and to the compassion and loyalty he had for others. I'm honored that Ed asked that I participate in the celebration of his life. Ed was an amazing man who donated his time to his community and impacted the lives of all people that met him. He was a true visionary who made possible for youth to participate in sports. And though Ed's no longer with us, his legacy will continue to be felt for generations to come. Ed, my friend, you will be missed. Rest in peace.
Ed Sackfield moved to Richmond Hill in 1951 when he was 24, a motivated young man full of energy and determination on making this small town a better place for all who lived here. He was a Town of Richmond Hill supporter, a Hockey Association leader, and a dedicated community member. That's how most of you will know him and remember him. But to nine of us, Ashley, Matthew, Philip, Melissa, Bradley, April, Jake, Brianne, and Katie, he was our papa. And to 13, Holden, Benjamin, Rachel, Piper, Peyton, Talon, Logan, Jackson, Leah, Zoe, Nathan, Ethan, and Wyatt, he was a great papa. Today, we are here to remember the life and legacy of our guy. For those of you who I haven't met, I am Ashley, Ed's oldest grandchild. Today, I would like to reflect on the person our grandpa was. Our papa was a proud man who prioritized hard work over wealth, respected others, and cared deeply for his family. Almost two decades after losing my grandma, papa ensured that not a moment passed without hugging us and expressing his love. His affection wasn't always tender. He also knew how to provide tough love and enforce the rules. Speaking his mind and standing to his word were very much second nature. If he wanted something done at the cottage, you better do it now and you better do it right. He couldn't just sit still and he would be in there, like my grandma would say, like a dirty shirt. How fortunate are we as grandchildren and great-grandchildren to say that we knew him and that he lived a beautiful life for 96 years. While the pain of his absence is heartbreaking, we're grateful he attended some significant milestones, such as baptisms, graduations, weddings, and the joy of seeing us become parents, along with building relationships with our kids, his 13 great-grandchildren, and hearing the exciting news of a 14th great-grandchild on the way. For years, we have playfully debated who Papa's favorite grandchild was, and the truth is, we all were. Each of us forged unique relationships with him, and he always made you feel like you were the most important person in the world when you had a conversation with him. He always tried to make everything fun, even the smallest of activities, like him paying us anywhere from a nickel to a quarter to comb his hair or tickle his back, proving that even loose change can add a touch of laughter to life's littlest moments. I think it's safe to say that most of us also loved when him and Grandma would drive us to the cottage and would stop in Wyville for ice cream. It quickly became a tradition to stop there. Papa would either get rum and raisin or tiger tail flavor, although a few times he was forced to get bubblegum. Whether we found ourselves in the bed of his truck heading to the boat launch, accompanying him to the dump with the tunes of his Buddy Holly tapes filling the air, engaging in a lively crib or euchre tournament at the cottage, or even practicing our driving skills in a snowstorm on the way to a hockey game, he was always ready for a good time and to make us grandkids happy. He remained a child at heart, which was most evident on Christmas mornings. For many years, we lived together, my parents, brothers, and I, along with Grandma and Papa. Come Christmas morning, waking up was merely a formality, as he would already be wide awake, surrendering to the infectious excitement. Growing up, he was always just our Papa, but for others who were raised in Richmond Hill, he was a local legend. Friends would often say to us, "Your grandpa has an arena?" We would always respond yes, implying that he owned it, as opposed to him being named after it. Papa's love for craftsmanship was evident in his beautiful pieces that he created with his hands. The coffee tables, shelves, snowman that he meticulously crafted were just objects. Sorry, were not just objects. They were reflections of his creativity and the love that he poured into everything that he did. These tangible expressions of his skills will continue to adorn our homes, serving as reminders of his enduring presence. In the week before he passed, I asked him what the most significant memory he had was. He took a second, but he said, "Meeting my grandma." He had shot her with a BB gun, and well, the rest is history. He said it was his favorite for two reasons. One, he met the love of his life. And two, it was the beginning of an amazing life that they had created together. I also asked if he was proud of his family, and without hesitation, he said, "How could I not be? Everyone has grown up and become incredible humans, and they've all built their own families and kept the Sackfield name and reputation going." Although he was proud of us, we are proud and honored to be a part of his family. There was no one like him. He was truly one of a kind. In bidding farewell to our beloved Papa and Great Papa, let us not mourn the loss, but celebrate the enduring legacy he leaves behind. His teachings, his love, and his spirit will continue to guide us through the journey of life. As we carry his strength in our hearts, let us also strive to emulate the qualities that made him the extraordinary person that he was. To our Papa and Great Papa, I would like to say, rest easy now. Your work is done. Your legacy is assured. You will remain in our hearts today, tomorrow, and always.
The first thing I'd like to read is a note that came from Brian Wilford, a former member of parliament for this area, and his wife, Elizabeth. It says, "Dear family and friends of Ed, it was an honor to be asked by Ed to say a few words about the man who he had the privilege to know for 40 years. There were few people in life who can make the impact he made on his community and everyone he came in contact with. Goodness is about character, integrity, honesty, kindness, generosity, moral courage, and the like. More than anything else, it is about how we treat other people. People are naturally drawn to him. He was a true gentleman at all times. I had the honor of seeing Ed in various venues, from being at his cottage, which he loved and hosted the Richmond Hill Arena Association golf tournaments for over 30 years, to other golf courses, and to being an arena board member. We often had many political discussions, and he always respected others' views, but was never afraid to challenge a person or to stand his ground. His ever-present smile, sense of humor, but most importantly, his kindness and gentle nature touched us all. He had a sense of purpose and an understanding of the value of life. His contributions to Richmond Hill are well known, but his passion for the Arena Association, seeing people enjoy the facilities and being able to be a part of the organization that was unique in the province, was a legacy that he has left us. Just a quick announcement before I say my piece here. Following the service, the procession will be leaving the parking lot. The police are going to get us on to Major McKenzie, where we'll be making a right-hand turn and heading towards Bathurst. We'll make a right on Bathurst to Elgin Mills, right on Elgin Mills, and then straight through to the cemetery. For those that do not wish to attend the internment at the cemetery, you're free to go straight to Oakview Terrace, which is on Leslie, north of Stouffville Side Road. There will be tea and coffee available at that time. Lunch will be served, or sandwiches, around 1 o'clock. And for those that want something stronger, there will be a cash bar. I'd first like to thank everyone for attending my father's service here today. Your condolences and well wishes are very much appreciated by everyone in the family. I would especially like to thank those that have traveled great distances to be here, as I know it can be a difficult endeavor. I could begin to list all of my father's accomplishments, awards, and honorariums, but I was instructed to try and keep it short. Besides, everyone here is quite aware of the public Ed Sackfield. Instead, I thought I would talk about Ed, the husband, father, grandfather, and great-grandpa. When her mother passed away almost 20 years ago, it was a shock to many, as it had always seemed that Dad had the poorer health. But what really struck us children was how Dad initially became flustered as he missed her so much. Here was a man who had operated businesses and organizations, built homes and cottages, repaired plumbing, electrical work, and many landscaping jobs. But all of a sudden he was asking how to fry an egg or cook a roast. Pretty much anything but that was not barbecue related. He adapted, as he always did, and was soon competent in the kitchen as well. Us children remember Dad as a workaholic. At home, he was always on the go when we were expected to help. At the cottage, when he decided to expand the original structure, Rob and I had mixed feelings about visiting on our weekends off. At this time, we were both working, so the thought of spending the entire weekend at the cottage laying stone, sanding, or painting something was not all that appealing. But it was the cottage, and we had more than enough time to enjoy the boat, the water activities that were provided to us. He was a worrying father as well, often staying up late until one of us, Beth, who had stayed out too late and finally straggled in. He was a tough but loving father. Our home on Westwood Lane when we were young was perfect kids' playground. Lots to do, and Dad never seemed to complain about the destructions we did to the garage door, the lawn, the hedge, and the front door. Many a puck went through that glass door. When we moved to Richmond Street in 1967, it was a beehive of activity over the years. Visits from the Adleys, the Acombs, the Grahams, the Joslins, the Clements, the Lazenbys, the Duffys, the Barrows, both Tubby and Dave, Toporoskis, the Rices, and so many others. If there was a worthwhile endeavor to be tackled, Dad was an eager volunteer and instilled in us, his children, that it was beneficial to help when you were able. As the grandchildren started coming into his life, he glowed in their childlike excitement and spoiled them with treats. When they got older, he liked telling them about his childhood, and they were both amused and amazed at all the things he had done. As for the great-grandchildren, he enjoyed seeing them and trying to get them to laugh, but his age and his never-ending hearing deterioration made it both frustrating and difficult to manage. In the past few years, many of Dad's close friends and relatives had passed on, and despite our visits, he became lonely. I used to compare him to the old war movies, where the surviving platoon member returns home and keeps asking, "Why me? Why am I still alive?" Many of you may be wondering about my father's final months and the way things ended. But after he passed, I read some of his journal that he had kept for the past 15 years or so. On an entry dated December the 16th, he wrote the following. I feel like my time on earth is over. Thank you, God. Make it over tonight. I have a great family and a wonderful marriage. I love all of the kids, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. I'm so happy with the way things turned out. I had a great life and can't complain. He was able to leave on his terms. Rest in peace, Dad. You are loved and will be missed.
Can say for certain, maybe you're still here. I feel you all around me, your memory so clear. Deep in the stillness, I can hear you speak. You're still an inspiration, can it be? That you are mine, forever love, and you are watching over me from up above. Fly me up to where you are beyond a distant star. I wish upon tonight to see you smile. If only for a while to know you're there. A breath away is not far to where you are. Are you gently sleeping here inside my dream? And isn't faith believing all power can't be seen as my heart holds you just one beat away? I cherish all you gave me every day, 'cause you are mine, forever love, watching me from up above. And I believe that angels breathe, and that love will live on and never leave. Fly me up to where you are beyond a distant star. I wish upon tonight to see you smile. If only for a while to know you're there. A breath away is not far to where you are. I know you're there. A breath away is not far to where you
Our service continues with the reading of Scripture, and I call upon April for our first reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor nothing taken from it. God has done this, so that all should stand in awe before him. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand and gives it light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, dear Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Sitting on the mountaintop under a beautiful blue sky, shaded by the green of a tree, Jesus slowly delivers his gift to the disciples. He preaches words of direction and love, and he delivers the Sermon on the Mount. He begins with the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. But do we really know what a blessing is? Or how a blessing feels? The world in which we live doesn't talk about blessings or being blessed. We talk about being happy. Jesus begins his teaching not with promises of happiness, but with promises of blessedness. Beatitudes don't just remind the disciples and us that we are blessed. Jesus wants them and us to feel that we are blessed. It may be hard to feel blessed today, but we are. We are gathered here today to celebrate Ed, who, like all of us, was salt of the earth, light of the world, and a blessing to this city and to each of us. We have heard in our time of remembrance stories from Ed's family and colleagues and friends, and the sharing of how much he meant to us and how he touched our lives. And those stories will continue to be told and the memories shared in the days and weeks ahead. Sometimes with laughter, and at other times with tears. Ed will not be forgotten by any of us. I always say to people who are grieving that the next 2 years may be filled with times of sorrow as life grows around the grief that has now touched them. We don't get over our grief. Life grows around it. Each of us will be touched by sorrow because of Ed's death, whether we are a member of his immediate family, a member of his church community, or a former coworker, neighbor, or longtime friend. Each of us has our own memories, and it's important to continue to share those memories and stories with each other. Dear community members today, we need the work that Ed started to continue. We need the love he showed for this incredible community he served for so many years to continue. The Beatitudes are a call to action for the sake of creating the world I believe God imagines. When our imagination is limited, when our hope for the future might have been dimmed, when we think what we do and what we say and what we believe does not matter, we only need to remember our friend, mentor, colleague, and family member, Ed. Jesus gave the Beatitudes sitting on a hill. Ed gave his energy building up our hill, Richmond Hill. He did not hide his light under a lampstand. He let his light shine before others so that he might give his good works. And while he may not have said it in so many words, he gave glory to his Father in heaven. Ed's death is not the end. It is a new beginning as he takes the place that has been prepared for him. God did not take him. God has received him, and he has been given the rest he deserves after all he has done. A rest where sorrow and pain are no more. Continue to see Ed in what happens around you. When you're eating ice cream, say a little prayer for him, especially if it's bubblegum. If you drive by the arena named after him, which, by the way, I thought he owned it too, raise a little prayer for him. Cry if you need to, laugh when you can, and continue to share your memories, because I believe those are gifts from God. Ed made life different, and he definitely made life better. Thanks be to God. Alleluia and amen.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia plena, Ave, Ave Dominus, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu in mulieribus, et benedictus, et benedictus fructus ventris, ventris tui, Jesus. Ave Maria. Ave Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, ora ora pro nobis, ora, ora pro nobis, peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis, in hora mortis nostre, in hora mortis, mortis nostre, in hora mortis nostre. Ave Maria.
Thank you.
Our service continues on page 592 of your green prayer book, which should be in front of you in your pew. 592. Would you please stand? And I invite you to say it along with me as long as you're comfortable. It's the Apostles' Creed on 592. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our God. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And our service continues with our prayers, and I'll call upon Brianne and Katie to come forward. You may kneel or sit for our prayers, please.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace.
May all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life. And may we with him pass through the grave and gate of death to our joyful resurrection.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you a quiet mind.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to all who mourn and a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow onto you, they may know the consolation of your love.
Hear us, Lord.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in a joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant us grace to entrust Ed to your never-failing love, which sustained him in this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and remember him according to the favor you bear for your people.
Hear us, Lord.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Would you please stand? Our service continues on page 595. Let us pray together the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of